Well, hey, good morning, everybody. Really great to be together. Whether you come every week or this is your first week, we're really grateful for an opportunity we have to gather in this place. Before we look into God's word, I just want to take a moment. We're going to take a moment and pray for our opportunity to give. This is a chance that we have as members of this church, people who consider Harvest your church home. So if you're new, that this part's not for you, you can just turn it off for a little while. It's totally fine. But this is something that we do as a church body. You know, so often, our giving is an opportunity to really worship the Lord in an action, as something that's tangible that I can do to worship the Lord. And it is important for each of us as believers to do that and to grow in that. And sometimes I can get so busy that I kind of pass by all opportunities to be generous. And sometimes I can get so busy even in my routine of giving that I can forget to slow down and take a moment and recognize that I'm doing this as an opportunity to worship the Lord. And so there's different ways on the screen behind me, ways that we can give. These are all of the ways that we give as a church, but all of it really is an opportunity for me to declare to the Lord that He's worth all of it to me. And so we're going to do that now. Let's pray. We're going to take a moment and pray over our opportunity to give and over the rest of our gathering together. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for the immense gift and generosity that you've given us of your Son, Jesus Christ, on the cross for our sins, that we can be forgiven and cleansed of all of our unrighteousness and put into a right standing before you, not because of what we could do, but only because of your generosity to us. And God, because of that, we desire to give all of our lives over to you, to worship you with our songs, with the things that we say and the things that we sing, and to worship you with our lives, and to worship you in just a moment with the way that we lean in and learn from your word together, and to worship you with our giving, both here at this place and in other places that you would have us to give generously. Lord, would we mimic and imitate your generosity to us as we give to others? Would it be a fragrant offering to you as we give it back? Lord, as we go now to the reading of your word and looking into all that you have said to us, God, would you, by your Spirit, open the eyes of our minds and our hearts to receive what you would have for us today? Let us be changed, not because of anything that would necessarily happen, humanly speaking, with us, but because of your word to us, Lord. Would you do it in our hearts and in our minds and in our lives today? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, go ahead and grab hold of your Bibles. We're continuing our series, Thus Saith the Lord, where we're walking through a number of prophets. We're going to be in this just for two more weeks, really, is all it is. This and one more. Today we're in Isaiah 40. Isaiah 40. We were in Isaiah 6 last week, so you should know right where it is and be able to get there quickly. But Isaiah 40 is going to be our spiritual food for today. You know, a lot of times when you come to church, you look to get something out of our time in the Word, right? It's okay. I understand. You look to get something out of it. Lord, maybe you're going to challenge me today. We've talked a lot in our series about repentance, about the things that each of us have in our lives that we need to turn away from and turn towards the Lord. So maybe we come for a message of repentance, of challenge, and maybe we come for a message of instruction. God, help me figure out how I can live my life in a way that honors you more. Maybe we come for direction. God, I just feel lost, and I just need to know from your word where you would send me. Sometimes we come for a word of challenge. Today is a message of comfort. And we desperately need that at times. We need an opportunity from God's word to be comforted. And today is a message of comfort. And if you're in that place, it's a message just for you. And if you're not, it's one to hold on the back burner for days that are difficult. This section of God's word is one that's directed to the people of Israel in the future. when they're in captivity. You see, Isaiah is proclaiming a message to God's people, and most of the book is actually a book of coming judgment for the people of Israel. They've been far from the Lord and continuing in their patterns of idolatry, and so most of the book of Isaiah, he's telling them about what's coming in the future, about this difficult time that is coming, and we can look back now and see that in Israel's past. But even as he's proclaiming this future judgment that's coming, Isaiah takes a bit of a pause here in Isaiah 40, and he's saying that there's judgment coming, a difficult time is coming, but even in the midst of that difficult time in your lives, you have to know that God is near to you in the midst of it, that he's a God of comfort and of compassion, and that he's only allowing these difficult things in your lives to grow you. And it's a message that we have of comfort for us, that when these difficult times happen in our lives, we can see them as a sign that God's actually at work, that he's doing something and he's very near to us in the midst of it. And he would say, even in the beginning of this chapter, comfort, comfort to my people. So often we think that what I need is a change of circumstance. I need things to change today. And lots of times, honestly, I need a nap. Lots of times I need to just take a little bit of a break and to say to myself, it's going to be okay. Maybe I should just eat something and take a nap for a moment and receive some comfort. And what we're going to see here is the very character of God. Because what Isaiah does here is he's telling them that there's a difficult time coming. It's going to be awful. And in the midst of that, he's not saying what you need to know in that is everything's going to be fine. You should just follow your heart and believe that everything's going to work out. You know, these positive thoughts that you have, that'll get you through it. No, he doesn't say any of that. Instead, what he says, in the midst of a wearying season, in the midst of a wearying world, what you need to know is who God is. What you need to know is that you have a God who's near to you. And we read this passage earlier. Pastor John read it to us, the end of our passage that we'll get to in just a moment. And he says that you'll renew your strength. If we're going to renew our strength in the midst of a wearying world and a wearying season, what do we need? And he tells us here in this passage, in the whole passage, we're going to look at this whole book together. He tells us five characteristics of God that would grant us strength in a wearying world. We need to remember these five things about God. First, God is compassionate. God is compassionate. Let's begin reading our text together. Isaiah 40, verse 1 and following. He says, "Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, and she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries, 'In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken.'" Again, he begins this passage with comfort, comfort to my people. If you look back just the last page in Isaiah 39, what happens here is this story. Hezekiah the king, he invites the Babylonians in to the household of God, and he shows them all of the great things of the land. Essentially, what Hezekiah is doing, he's bragging to these foreign people about, look at all this gold we have, look at all this stuff that we have. And he's doing it in his own might, in his own sense of entitlement, sense of accomplishment. And what God does through Isaiah is he proclaims judgment that's coming. Because you have trusted in yourself in the midst of this, there's going to be great judgment that's coming. You're going to be taken into captivity by these very people that you brought in to brag about. They're going to be like, well, that gold that we saw, that that looks like a great idea. We should come and take that. And they're going to do that. And so Isaiah proclaims this. That's going to happen. When you're gone, there's going to be great judgment and there's difficulty. But right on the back end of that prophecy of the coming judgment comes this prophecy that we have of God's comfort. You see, God doesn't want his people to see the difficult things coming without the good news that follows. And he's been proclaiming God's judgment because of their unfaithfulness, because of their idolatry. And when that judgment arrives, the message of hope for God's people that he is a compassionate God that is very near to them. He says, comfort, comfort to my people. If you remember last week, we talked about Isaiah 6 with the repetition of words, how that functioned in their language. And so he's saying it again to drill down and say, comfort, comfort. There's deep comfort that comes from the Lord. And notice he says, he calls them my people, says your God. It's a very personal thing. There's ownership that comes from the from our compassionate God, that he's a loving father, that even as he brings about discipline to them, there's great comfort in knowing that God is very near. We see this all the time with parents. And if you had parents who were angry and harsh in punishing you, I'm sorry, and I'm confident that they're sorry as well. If your parents, like all parents, lost their temper and they were angry with you as a child, as many, most, all parents do at times, they're sorry. But that's not who our loving Heavenly Father is. He's not like me as a father who gets irritated at times, who gets impatient, who gets angry when things don't work out. He's a perfect and loving father who would say, comfort, comfort. And maybe you didn't experience that growing up. Maybe your experience of your parents was anything but comfort, was anything but peace, was anything but compassion. But know, as we read this text, that it is true of our Heavenly Father, that he disciplines us even in those difficult times out of a desire to grow us, out of a love for us. And that even as he shepherds us through that pain, and through that suffering, he does that to accomplish his good purposes. He says here to speak tenderly, like a mother speaking to her young child who's scared of the dark. He's gentle and he's kind with us in the midst of those difficulties. And he says here, prepare the way of the Lord. This is what's quoted later about John the Baptist. Prepare the way of the Lord and calling people to prepare the way for Jesus the King. And I have to be honest, I've read the Bible a bunch of times. You'll be happy to know that as one of your pastors, that I have read it before. But every time that I have read that in the Gospels, I have always read it with a call to judgment, a call to like get your act together, prepare the way of the Lord. I have always read it that way. And I've read this passage before, but in studying this passage this week, the context is tender and kind. It's not judgment at all. It's not get ready, prepare the way of the Lord because it's coming. Listen, I know things are difficult right now. Get ready, God's coming. Like it's dripping with compassion and with mercy as he calls that God is coming. Our Heavenly Father, he takes special care of us in the sorrow, in the difficult times. He's not distant. He's suffering with us and he's longing to restore and he's near to the brokenhearted as he calls out like, get ready, God's coming. You might be in a difficult season right now, and you might be feeling like, God, what has happened? Prepare the way of the Lord. He's coming. He's coming. The end of the trial is coming, and he's near to you in the midst of it. We have a God who's entered in the midst of our pain and is very near to us. Do you know that in the Gospels, there are three times when Jesus cries? When we see Jesus specifically crying, the last is in the Garden of Gethsemane where he's weeping, tears of blood. Why is he weeping? It's right before he goes to the cross. He willingly will allow himself to be betrayed by his closest friends, to be arrested, to be beaten and bloodied, and then to willingly allow himself to be killed on a cross for your sins and for mine, knowing all of that's going to happen, knowing he's going to rise the third day, but he weeps in that garden over your sin and over mine that he's going to bear. He's going to take care of it, and yet he weeps. The second is in Luke 19, the second place where Jesus cries. He's weeping over Jerusalem. You can see him there standing on the hill overlooking the city of Jerusalem, weeping, knowing that judgment is coming. And he says, so often I would have gathered you as a mother hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were unwilling. Listen, Jerusalem, I tried. And if you would just turn to the Lord, but he weeps over the judgment, knowing that it's going to be okay, knowing that he's going to provide a way, but he still weeps. The first time in Scripture that we see Jesus weeping is in John 11. It's the shortest verse in all of the Bible. If you're looking for an easy memory verse, John 11, 35, Jesus wept. It's the shortest verse in all of the Bible, but it perhaps is one of the most powerful because the context of that, John 11, is where Lazarus dies. Jesus is standing there with his close friends, Mary and Martha, with Lazarus, somebody who was a good friend of his, and he's died. Now, Jesus knows what he's going to do. He had already told the disciples he's coming to raise Lazarus. But as he sits in their pain, he weeps with them, knowing full well that he's going to turn their sorrow into joy, their mourning into dancing in like 15 seconds. But he doesn't overlook the opportunity to sit in the pain and to give comfort to them. And they say, as they see Jesus weeping, look how much he loved them, displaying his love and his compassion. That's our compassionate God. Those are the three times that we see Jesus weep in the Gospels, and they echo Psalm 103:13 that says, as a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. C.S. Lewis would tell us that pain insists upon that's being attended to. You have to pay attention when that pain is happening. And he says that God whispers to us in our pleasure. He speaks to us in our conscience, but he is shouting to us in the midst of our pain. It's his megaphone to rouse us and a deaf word. When pain is happening, we have a compassionate God who sits and weeps with us in the midst of it and would say, comfort, comfort my people. We want to increase in strength in the midst of a wearying world. Remember that we have a compassionate God who's with us in the midst of it, who feels all of the pain and shows up in the midst, that God is compassionate. If we're to increase in strength, remember that God is faithful to his word. Secondly, let's continue reading verse 6. A voice says, cry, and I said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows on it. Surely the people are grass, and the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. This grass, it comes in quickly, and it grows quickly, and then it dies off just as quickly. That all people, all of life is like a breath. We studied in Ecclesiastes that it's hebel, it's fleeting, it's a vapor. And that's what Isaiah is saying here, that it's grass. But the promises, the word of our God, they will last forever. He continues verse 9, go up on a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up. Fear not, say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord God comes with his might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him and his recompense before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom and gently lead those who are with young. There's a confidence here. Lift up your voice with strength. Fear not. There's a confidence that God will bring to pass the things that he's said will come to pass. We have the picture of him as a shepherd, a powerful and yet loving shepherd to his people. Each time when we see in Scripture that God's judgment is coming, we can be confident that it is coming, and we can be confident that it's coming quickly, and we can be confident that he is coming with it, that he will be near to us as a shepherd in the midst of it, that we can be certain of God's promises to us. You know, our world is filled with people who give empty promises. We just got done with a convention right here, and regardless of who you're going to vote for, in my experience, every politician from every party is full of all sorts of promises that won't add up. Every one of them. I mean, we're going to cut taxes, and we're going to be about working class families. They're going to have more and be happier, and somehow your favorite sports team is going to win the championship. All you have to do is vote for me. It's a promise. And listen, I believe that some of those promises are well-intended. I hope to do this. But we interchange those words all the time. I hope for something, and I promise for something. You see, for a promise to really come to pass, a couple of things have to happen. There have to be an intention by the person who's making the promise. I'm going to keep that promise no matter what. I said it, and I'm going to be faithful to that. There also has to be an ability to keep that promise. Because you and I, we do it all the time, where we'll promise something, and I may not be able to keep that. I'm very careful. My kids know this. I'm very careful as a father. Like, I say a lot of stupid stuff, just to be clear. They will nod. They may not now because they're being nice. But I say a lot of stupid stuff as a dad. I do. But I'm very careful. I don't promise unless I'm sure I can make that thing happen. And even in that, there are promises that I have meant to keep, but I'm just not able to. But what we see here is that he's keeping all of his promises. He has the willingness to keep those things and the ability to keep those things. He not only desires to, he will keep those promises. He has the might to be able to do that. God's promises will stand because he is a faithful and powerful God. He is a God who is faithful to his word no matter what. And if you want to increase your strength, remember that nothing will stop the Lord from keeping his promises, from doing what he plans. His word has always come to pass, and it always will, because God is faithful to his word. Third, God is wise. This is what Isaiah is telling us, how we can stir up and increase our strength in the midst of a wearying world. We're to recognize that God is all wise. Let's continue to read verse 12. He says, "Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand and marked off the heavens with a span? He's enclosed the dust of the earth in a measure and weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance. Who has measured the spirit of the Lord, or what man shows him his counsel? Whom did he consult, and who made him understand? Who taught him the path of justice and taught him knowledge and showed him the way of understanding?" I love the pictures that Isaiah is painting here to tell us of God's wisdom. He tells us that who's measured the waters in the hollow of his hand. You know that Google is super helpful. Did you know that it's estimated there are 352 quintillion gallons of water in the oceans? Do you know how much that is? Just say, no, I don't. It's a lot. It's a whole lot. 352 quintillion gallons of water in the ocean. And Isaiah says he holds it in the hollow of his hand, the small part of his hand. All of the oceans, everything in them, God holds that in the hollow of his hands. It says that he marked off the heavens with a span. Did you know that it's estimated that there are about 200 billion trillion stars in the universe? Do you know how much that is? Just say, no, I don't. It's a lot. And our God, 200 billion trillion stars in the universe, and our God has marked them all off with the span of his hand. It's like holding your hand up. That's all of them. That's every one of the stars. That's our God. He's marked them all off with a span. It says, who has measured the Spirit of the Lord? Who has the wisdom to judge the Lord, to put some kind of a test up to the Lord and test how smart or how wise he is? You know, some parents are really grateful that most schools are starting tomorrow. You know, and my kids are dreading already the first quiz and the first test that'll happen. I don't know if you know this, but we're partnering with a Christian school that's going to be renting out our building, and they're going to start meeting tomorrow morning. It's their first day of school. It's a brand new school called Chicago Christian Academy, and we're grateful for the partnership that we have to raise kids in Christian education right here in our building. It's super cool. So we have that happening. Moody Bible Institute, you're going to see all the college students come back this next weekend. It's super exciting, but every one of them is going to have a test. There's going to come a day when they're tested, when they're amount of knowledge and wisdom is put to the test. And what Isaiah is saying here is, who could possibly test the wisdom of our God? He holds up his hand and measures all of the stars of the heavens. He holds out his hand and cups it slightly, and all of the oceans and all that's in him fits in the small part of his hand. He is a wise God. And so often you and I would go through a difficult time, a difficult season, and think that we know better somehow than a God who's measured the heavens with his hand and held his hand out, and every one of the oceans has fit within it. But we would think that somehow I know better with my puny little brain. Like, my dental hygienist, every time I go in, has this thing that, like, I should just quit my job and spend all of my time flossing and using those little dental pick things. And she's like, you should do this, I mean, twice a day. Take those little dental picks. I like her. I don't mean to make fun of her. But, like, use those little dental picks every time. And every time I'm sitting there, I'm like, yeah, I'm not going to do that. Like, I know better somehow. Her job is to take care of people's teeth. But somehow, in my laziness, I'm like, nah, I'll be fine. It's fine. I can get around that. So somehow, I have greater wisdom than someone who's gone to school to take care of people's teeth. But we would so often look at our lives and say, God, I don't understand all of the stuff that's happening here. I don't get it all. And I know you say some of these things in your word, and you tell me the way that I'm supposed to live, but, like, have you read this? There's a lot of stuff that's really hard in here. Like, you want me to forgive someone who's hurt me? You want me to love my enemy? I don't know. I think maybe I know a little bit better than you do, God, even though you're all wise and hold all of the oceans in the palm of your hand. But we would so often come back to that, and so often trust in ourselves and our own wisdom and what I think is best. And what Isaiah is telling us is that if you want to increase in strength in your life in the midst of a weary, weary world, trust that God is wise, that our circumstances, they only make sense in God's economy, that day to day, it might seem like I know better, and I'm not going to floss today. Trusting that God is all wise, even in the weariness of my own life, it may not make sense to my puny brain that can't comprehend these things, but a God who would hold his hand up and measure all of the stars in the universe would say, trust me, I'm wise. Who could put me to the test for all of this? I know what I'm doing. And if you want to increase in strength, increase in trust of a God who is all wise. Fourthly, trusting that God is sovereign. Let's continue reading verse 15. Behold, the nations, they're like a drop from a bucket. They're accounted as dust on the scales. Behold, he takes up the coastlands like fine dust. Lebanon would not suffice for fuel, nor its beasts enough for a burnt offering. All the nations are as nothing before him. They're counted as him as less than nothing and emptiness. Again, I love the word pictures as we're leaning into the fact that God is sovereign. It's a drop from a bucket. It's like dust on the scale that it's just gone. It says that he takes up the coastlands like the fine dust. All of the beaches in the entire world, they're just like vapor and dust to our God. All of these things that we think are important and are significant and are great, they're insignificant and tiny in compared to God's sovereignty. The picture here of Lebanon was known for its massive forests and great wild animals that roamed these forests. And what's being said here is you could gather together all of the biggest and best trees and all of the animals that you could imagine and offer them as a sacrifice, and they pale in comparison to who God is. These things are so tiny in the midst of a sovereign God. He continues verse 18, to whom then will you liken God? Or what likeness will you compare with him? I love the sarcasm that Isaiah is getting at here. Sarcasm is it's a love language for me, just so you know. Me and Isaiah, I think, would be friends. But he goes, who then will you liken God? Who are you gonna compare him to? Verse 19, an idol. That's who you're going to compare God to. This tiny little idol, a craftsman crafts it. He overlays it and a goldsmith overlays it with gold and casts for it silver chains. He's too impoverished for an offering. He chooses wood that will not rot. And he seeks out a skillful craftsman to set up an idol that will not move. It goes about like this expensive project of trying to build this thing, this tiny little idol. Isn't it just like God? That's the sarcasm that Isaiah is talking about here. It won't move even the best that we could build or offer. It's nothing compared to a God who's sovereign. His point in all of this is how ridiculous it is to try to replace God with something. And I think, you know, we realize this, that like building of some little, we sort of read these things and we're like, this is ridiculous. Why would they build this? Why would they think that this is more important than God? But you and I, we may not take a piece of wood or gold, but far too often we take the things in our lives and we treat those things like they're more significant, like they're more sovereign, the relationships we have in our lives. But this is the most important thing to me. And God, as long as you fit within this, then it's okay. Or I'm going to trust in my finances, in my ability to provide for myself, or my bank account, or these things that are in my life that I think that this is going to provide for me in all of these ways, and believe that it's more important or more significant than a sovereign God. Maybe it's my career, that as long as I can advance myself and keep growing in these things, that I have all that I'll need. But these things, they're pale in comparison to a sovereign God. He continues verse 21, do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in, who brings princes to nothing and makes the rulers of the earth as emptiness. Scarcely they are planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows on them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. His point in all of this is it's so obvious when you look at all of the things of this life that are here for a moment and gone the next. It's obvious that God has always been mighty over these. The princes are brought to nothing. The strongest and the most powerful people that we would see, they're really nothing. It actually says that they amount to grasshoppers. They're just little insignificant bugs around us. They're here one moment and gone the next. And the things that you and I and the people that you and I believe are so important and so mighty, they're just little grasshoppers that are gone the next moment. He continues verse 25, "To whom then will you compare me that I should be like him?" says the Holy One. "Lift up your eyes and on high and see who created all of these. He who brings out their host by number, calling them all by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, not one of them is missing." What he's talking about here, lift up your eyes and see in the sky. He's talking again about all that we would see in the heavens, about the stars and the sky and the planets. You see, pagan worship pretty much all over the place. They were surrounded by different astrological signs, and they believed that those somehow told us what to do and directed our steps. And even today, some people would say, like, there's mercury in my Gatorade, so does that mean that I'm supposed to be okay for being a jerk today? Like, we look at these astrological signs, and people would say, well, my horoscope said this, and so that takes care. Like, that's what he's talking about here. It's like, look up in the skies and see all of these things that you see so significant. But who can compare these to me, says the Holy One. I actually recently heard kind of a funny thing about horoscopes. Someone said, so can someone tell me which planet it is that's making me sad right now? And someone else said, I'm pretty sure it's Earth. And that's just for free. But we've said already that there are approximately 200 billion trillion stars in the universe, and our God holds all of them in his hand. But here, Isaiah actually says that he brings out their hosts by number 200 billion trillion apparently, and it says that he's calling them all by name. Every single one of those stars that the Lord would hold up and measure by his hand, he not only knows how many they are, he knows them by name. Every single one of them. Not one of them is missing. He keeps track of every single one of those 200 billion trillion stars. Oh, he certainly cares for every one of his people. When we're going through a wearying time, when we're in the midst of a difficult season, maybe it's a season of judgment like coming for the people of Israel, maybe it's a season of trial for you, you can be certain that our perfect sovereign God has all of it under control. He holds all of it in his hands and won't forget a single one of them. Isaiah goes from the inhabitants of the earth and princes and rulers and supposed gods in the sky, but God rules over all of it, is what he's saying. Nothing happens at all in this world without his sovereign control. You see, we worry far too much about provision, about what it'll look like and how I'm gonna get there and how I'm gonna be okay. God holds all of it together. Our compassionate God, he's also a sovereign God. He has the power to keep his promises, and he has the desire to keep his promises because he's sovereign and because he's compassionate. So comfort, says the Lord God. Comfort my people, because if we want to increase in strength in the midst of a wearying world, know finally that God is worth waiting for, that he's worth waiting for. Let's finish reading together this great chapter. verse 27 through 31. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not grow faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. He says, my way is hidden from the Lord. So often we have felt this truth, that like everything is happening. Does God even see what's happening in my life? And Isaiah is pointing again to the future for the people of Israel. And they're going to be in a difficult season, far from home, in captivity. And they're going to have these same questions. And they're going to say, my way is hidden. Does God even see what is happening in my life? And how often you and I would feel those same things. We look at the tragedies in our own lives. We look at the weariness of it all. And we would say, God, is my way hidden from you? Do you see any of it? And the key here, what Isaiah calls us to, is to wait for the Lord. This is the center of the bullseye if you want to increase in strength. I think all of us recognize that the difficult things are, trials are in our life, and more trials are coming, and we desperately want to know, what are the tools that I need in the midst of that season to get through it, to be on the other side of it? And what he would say, what God would say to us, is the number one thing is wait on the Lord, is trust him through it. It's waiting. It's the center of the bullseye for the people of God. Waiting on a compassionate and faithful and wise and sovereign God. What does it look like to wait? Waiting, it's not a passive thing. I mean, it sounds like it. We have a picture of like, I'm going to go see my dental hygienist, and I'm sitting in that waiting room, just sitting there, maybe looking at a magazine or scrolling through my phone and just waiting for something to happen. But waiting for the believer is not a passive thing, it's a trusting thing. I've explained this a few ways before in our past, but just as a reminder, I want to give you what I think Scripture tells us waiting truly looks like. I have found that waiting on the Lord is potentially the most difficult thing in all of life. Waiting for God to remedy a situation, waiting for God to fix whatever I'm going through, waiting for God to come through, waiting for God to do something, because trust me, I've tried a lot to make it happen on my own, and I haven't seen any of that really work positively. It's waiting on the Lord to come through. So here's what I believe waiting biblically entails, as simply and as clearly as I can understand it. I believe that it's first coming to the Lord. Like Mary and Martha coming to Jesus as Lazarus was still in the tomb, coming to God, I don't really understand what's happening, but I'm coming to you. I'm pursuing you. I'm leaning into what the Lord is doing. It's very easy for us to run or to be frustrated or to try to do my own thing, but it's coming to the Lord. It's coming to the Lord. It's trusting in his plan. God, I don't understand what you're doing. I don't get it. I don't, but I'm trusting you. I'm letting go so that your plan will be accomplished. It's really easy for me to try to accomplish things and try to, if I could just have this conversation, if I could maybe just do this thing, if I could get to the right person, if I could get the right timing, if I could just, but it's opening our hands and trusting the Lord. God, I don't understand it. but I'm trusting you and I'm believing that you're going to work. It's coming to the Lord. It's trusting his plan. And it's, this maybe is the hardest thing. It's allowing for his timing. Because I'm really good at the like, is it time yet, God? Is it time yet, God? Is it time yet, God? I've been waiting for a while. It's letting go and trusting the Lord and accepting his timing. And it will always take longer than I want it to. But it's trusting that even in that timing is his perfect plan for it. And there's lots of things that I can try to do in the midst of that. I can still live my life doing the next right thing. I can do what God calls me to do right now. But I'm not trying to manufacture something in this situation. I'm not trying to make it happen. I'm not trying to take it on my own strength. I'm coming to the Lord. I'm trusting in his plan, and I'm allowing for his timing. It is a simple thing. I have found it to be pretty much the hardest thing in all of life, is just opening my hands with those three simple things. It's one of the main reasons it's so difficult, because I believe that I actually have some kind of power to accomplish anything of substance in my own life, when the cross is a clear show that I have nothing positive that I can actually bring to anything lasting in this world, that he's accomplished all of it for me, and I'm coming to him and I'm releasing it to him and I'm trusting in his timing, because he is a sovereign and he is a perfect, he is a compassionate and a wise and a faithful and a sovereign God who is always at work. And he would say to you and I today, comfort, comfort, my people. I've got it. I'm going to bring you through, and I'm working, so trust me through it. Father, we're grateful for this beautiful passage that we have, for the truths of Scripture. There are so many places that we often run to in times of trouble, and this is one of those passages. So God, allow us to have open hands to all that you're accomplishing in our lives, to run to you quickly and to trust you fully and to believe that you're working things far better than we ever could. Who could test the Lord? Who could show you what is right? But we would just pray, Lord, that you would increase our trust in you. God, would you give great comfort to your people as we wait for you to work? God, I would pray for those who are in a season of waiting and a season of heartache right now, who are in that trial, who are in a wearying land right now. God, would you be their comfort? Would you be very near to the brokenhearted, even who are hearing me right now? We thank you for your promises that stand true because you are a faithful and strong and wise God. Would you bring it to pass? Bring about your purposes to pass in our lives. We will be careful to give you all of the praise and all of the glory for it, because you've been faithful in the past and you will certainly be faithful in the future. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.